There is a word that the Lord has placed in my spirit on this day. It's just one verse found in Paul's letter to the church at Galatia. In the 6th chapter, I only want to read one verse, and I want to read it from the Message. You can remain seated. This verse from the Message translation, verse 17, Galatians chapter 6, reads this way. Quite frankly, I don't want to be bothered anymore by these disputes. I have far more important things to do, the serious living of this faith. And here is the phrase. I bear in my body the scars from my service to Jesus Christ. I bear in my body scars from my service to the Lord Jesus Christ. For just a few minutes, I want to preach as the Spirit shall guide with this thought in our minds. Evidence for an elevation. Evidence for an elevation. Most of you know several years ago, I had a very serious back surgery, 12-hour surgery on the front and on the back. I remember very vividly, not too long after the surgery and one of my post-op visits to my doctor, I went in to him and he began to examine my range and motion and to see how things were coming along. He looked at both of the incisions. There's a 6-inch incision in the front, a 14-inch incision going down my back. And he observed them and looked at them and he said to me, whenever you're ready to get that scar dealt with, we can send you to one of our cosmetic surgeons. They can clean it up and make it look almost unnoticeable. He said, I wouldn't worry too much about the one in the back. Nobody really sees the scar that's in the back. He said, but the one in the front is clearly visible. And I'm sure you might want to hide or get rid of that unsightly reminder of the pain you went through. He was speaking something to me that really has become big business in the age of looks. Cosmetic surgery has become a billion-dollar industry. And number one in the various options of cosmetic surgery is what they call scar removal. Scar removal is so huge because scars, for most people, are a symbol of disfigurement. Nobody likes to be disfigured or reminded of painful experiences. It reminds us that something went wrong or something was wrong that had to be corrected, or that I went through something that left its mark on me and changed my appearance. People line up to get scars removed because it suggests that if you have a scar, you are less than perfect. Now, if you can't afford surgery, they've created creams that you can put on that hide the scars and give you a false reality of your appearance. Pain is a reality that we never like to be reminded of. And we would rather find a way to escape it or elude it or deny it. And as I thought about that thing, it dawned on me, Jamal, that in a real and sad sense, many people have been using holiness as scar removal for a long time. We put on the mask and pretend as if everything is all right. We come to church and put up the shout for the saints to see to convince people that things are not as bad, when in reality, if we would just own the pain, it would give us something better to praise God about, because in owning the pain, I have to admit that I survived whatever caused the pain. Scars should not be things we try to hide. Scars are not and should not be seen as signs of weakness or imperfection. But scars can be signs of courage and trophies of victory. Because the only way to get a scar is to stay in the fight. You don't get scars from running away from a fight. You only get scars when you buckle down and stay in. It was said at the Battle of Waterloo, after the victory, that Napoleon gave out coins. On one side was a picture of himself, but on the other side were the words, "I was there." Because after you survive, you always want something that can be a reminder of your testimony, that you went through something, survived it, and you were there when he dried your tears. You were there when he lifted your spirit. You were there when he restored your joy. You were there when he paid those bills. You were there when he made your enemies your footstool. And every now and then, you need to pull the coin of your past out and remind yourself that you went through some battles and survived them and came out on the other side with the victory. Scars have a story, because people will look at you without having a clue what it took and what you went through to get to the point of where you are. So God allows scars as a launching pad, because the story of your life is not the destination, but the story of your life is the journey. Because there's more shouting in the journey than there is in the arrival. Because the journey had some things along the way that tried to block me, tried to stop me, tried to destroy me, tried to get rid of me. And when I can look back on the journey, I can shout about how I survived everything that tried to keep me from reaching my destiny. Scars can be signs of victory. That's what Paul viewed them as. But Paul has been dealing some time now with a faction of Jewish leaders who have done everything they can to delegitimize his apostolic authority. There were a group of Judaizers there in the church who were trying to appear spiritual by becoming circumcised and demanding that others follow them. But the problem with that was these leaders were trying to persuade the people of the church to be circumcised so they could boast about having them as followers. That they wanted something that would let them brag about the numbers they have increased in. Because to them, validity to their authenticity was in how many people they had following them. And Paul said, "You can brag about your numbers, but I will brag about my scars. Your evidence is in your numbers, but my proof is in my scars." And just in case you want to delegitimize my apostolic authority, I bear in my body the very scars of Jesus Christ that become the evidence that I am who I say I am. See, Paul stopped dealing with them theologically and dealt with them existentially, because the one thing you can't argue with is my own experience. You can debate theology with me, but you can't debate what the Lord did for me. You can debate whether Jehovah Jireh of the Old Testament is the Jesus provider of the New Testament, but what you can't debate with me is that when I was broke, he supplied all my needs. You can debate with me whether Jehovah Shalom of the Old Testament is the God of peace in Jesus in the New Testament, but you can't debate with me when I couldn't sleep, he rocked me to sleep at night. You can debate with me whether Jehovah Rapha of the Old Testament is the Jesus healer of the New Testament, but what you can't debate with me is when a doctor said I'd never preach, he healed my body. Because your experience is something people cannot argue with. And as I stand here today in front of my Father, the issue is not titles, the issue is scars. The issue is not elevation, the issue is scars. And just in case there's somebody wondering about the legitimacy of it, just in case there's somebody wondering why he didn't go through the ranks, just in case there's somebody wondering about the protocol, he bears in his body the scars of the Lord Jesus Christ. For 44 years, he's been bearing in his body
paralysis, and the doctor said he may not walk. He had prostate cancer, and God healed him. He was in a car accident where the car took flight, and nobody thought he would survive. They were told they could never have children, but their seed is standing in front of them. So before you talk about the validity of elevation, he's got the scars to prove that he is who God says he is. And there might be somebody else in here today. You can say, I might not have the degree, I might not have the title, but I got the scars. And the scars are the evidence of who God made me. Y'all sit down, I'm just talking, I ain't got long. He bears in his body. We, as preachers, put value on the wrong thing concerning what validates us. We think that the value of validation is in how big our church is, or how many folk we have on the roll, or how we shout, or the robes that we wear. But can I tell you today, when you take off that cassock and when you take off that collar, there better be some scars up under there that say, for God I live and for God I die. And daddy, if you never got a title, if you never got vestments, I thank God that I can see the scars that become the evidence of the anointing that's on your life. There were several scars Paul had. There were the scars of illegitimacy. Paul dealt with harsh persecution, particularly in Corinth, because he was seen as illegitimate. You know, they were trying to claim that he didn't have the authority of this apostolic elevation because he had not been in the presence of the resurrected Jesus Christ, in spite of the vision he was telling them he had had. And here they were saying, how could he have the nerve to preach and say things he says with the authority he claims he has when he's not even a legitimate apostle? He dealt with the scars of being talked about and ridiculed by those who felt like he had not come through the rank and been through the process to be an apostle. As I look at my father today, 44 years ago when he was called to pastor this church, I would dare say there was some right up in here who would say, listen, he's not legitimate enough to be the pastor in this place. He's a postal worker. He carries mail. He doesn't have big time degrees. He hadn't been to the Ivy League school. This is Bethel Church, where we have sophistication and sophistry and people who have great elocutionary skills. He's just a postman who went to high school with most of us. We see him as one of us and not as anybody elevated. But can I tell you today, that's the one God is looking for, the one who doesn't have all the qualifications. Can I tell you, that's the one God wants to bless, because God does not call the qualified, but he will qualify the called. God help me. God help me in here. He doesn't always call the qualified, but he'll snatch somebody who others say don't have it and slap his anointing on them and qualify them because of his power. Is there anybody in here today who can testify that 44 years ago you weren't exactly sure about it, but 44 years later you sit in this sanctuary with the evidence that when God slaps his anointing on you, he will qualify you? It's not about your qualifications. Abraham lied and pimped his wife. Noah needed Alcoholics Anonymous. Moses needed a speech therapist and had a murder rap. David was an adulterer. Samson visited hookers. Peter was a gangster. But God said, that's the one I'm looking for. Because when I look at their scars become their preaching material. And I thank God for my daddy, because it is his recognition the fact that God called him from the street that gives him the humility that he operates in. He has the sympathy and empathy towards other people. He doesn't walk around as if he thinks he's better than them. He doesn't walk around as if he thinks his title, it gives him the right to look down on other people. He treats them as if they are equal to him, because his scars become the evidence of his humility. There's something else. That scars are not a sign of the pain. The scars are a sign of the healing. Have you ever noticed on the cross of Calvary, Jesus said a whole lot of things. Father, forgive them. Woman, behold your son. Son, behold your woman, your mother. Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? I'm thirsty. It is finished. Into the hands I commend my spirit. The one thing you never heard him say was, I hurt. Because Jesus understood that pain is a part of the process of elevation to get where God wants you to be. If you don't want pain, you don't want elevation. If you don't want pain, you don't want to reach your destination. See, this new Pentecostal church, I got a real problem with, because we think if we throw enough money on the altar or speak enough tongues or get enough oil laid on our head that somehow we get immunity to problems. But somebody in here today can testify that it took the pain to get you where Jesus wanted you to be. I have discovered in my own life, Bishop Ellis, I used to preach good theology. I've been to school. I got every degree you can have. I know how to exegete. I know how to look into hermeneutics. I know how to homiletically structure a sermon. And I could stand up here and say all the right stuff, but it took some pain to teach me that power don't come from the books, but power comes from the pain of your experience. A scar is evidence that there was a hurt, but the scar stands as a sign that you're healed from the hurts. Whew. The scar means you don't have to be subject to the authority of the hurt or defined by the cause of the pain. A scar means I have moved past the place of the pain, and I'm in the process of healing from the pain. Any injury doesn't become a scar till the wound starts healing. So that scarring is a natural part of the healing process. And I just want to thank you, my Father, for showing me and showing other preachers that preaching becomes a scar. Because when you preach, I've seen some of your hurt. But when you preach, I never hear any of your bleeding. And I thank God that I've never seen you stand and use God's pulpit to practice beating up those who hurt you. I've seen the tears you've cried. I've heard the stuff they've said. I've heard the rumors they've done. I've seen those who shook your hand stab you in your back. But I thank God you taught me that when you get up in this pulpit and you open up your mouth, your preaching becomes the evidence that the hurt don't last and you can heal by what you preach. Thank you, Daddy, for showing me that I don't have to get back at people by standing up in the pulpit and using God's word to exact my revenge, but that when I heal, I can stand up here and say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I thank you that your preaching has become a scar. Because when you stand and open your mouth for 44 years, never heard you call anybody's name. Never heard you refer to specific incidents. Never heard you talk about who hurt you and who did what to you. But just like Paul, in spite of what they said, you kept on preaching. In spite of the rocks they threw, you kept on proclaiming. In spite of how they stabbed you in the back, you kept on preaching God's word. Thank you today that while I saw your tears, I never heard your bleeding. I'm done. Here's the last thing. Whenever I go to Mayo Clinic, still, if I have on a shirt that shows my scar, I always get asked two things. One, what happened to you? And two, who fixed it? So that the scar, Torin, gives me a chance to brag on the doctor. God help me right through in here. The scar doesn't lead me to talk about myself. The scar doesn't lead me to talk about my pain. But the scar leads me to use a reference to deliver other people to a doctor who fixed me and can fix them. Thank you, my Father, that when you preach, you never brag about yourself. You never talked about what God's allowed you to do. But every time you open up your mouth, you point us to the doctor. Thank you that every time you preach, you never talked about things you could brag about. You could brag that you went to Tuskegee. You could brag that you went to Edward Waters College. You could brag that you went to Columbia University to study music. You could brag that you were the president of social justice for the National Baptist Convention. You could brag that with age you have allowed yourself to stay contemporary. You could brag that you took a church from 600 to 14,000. But thank you, when you open up your mouth, you point us to the one who can fix you and heal you. And there might be 100 of y'all in here who can say, thank you, Bishop, that you didn't point me to yourself, but you pointed me to the doctor. Do I have about 100 of y'all in here who can look back on some sermons that he preached about the doctor and said, God, I thank you that you healed me because he pointed me in the right way? That's what Paul said. I don't brag on myself, but I brag on Jesus and him crucified. And so today, when we elevate you, I just want to thank you for the scars that become your evidence. No, you ain't been an overseer. No, you ain't had a district. No, you ain't been over a state. No, you haven't been over a region. Yes, you might be past the age that they say you ought to be elevated in, but when we strip you of that robe, you got scars that say, I belong where I am. Thank you today that you taught me how to preach. Thank you today that you're teaching me how to pastor. Thank you today that you're teaching me how to be a husband. Thank you today that you're teaching me how to be a man. Thank you today that you're teaching me how to be a friend. And I praise God that you gave me your name. And I make a promise to you, in the years to come, I'll never mess up your name. I'll never insult your name. I'll never make your name a shame. They can say whatever they want to say. I'll just show them my scars. I got to sit down, y'all. I ain't supposed to act like this at a consecration. But is there anybody here who can help me close this service and say, God, I thank you for the scars in my life. God, I thank you that I have evidence that you are a healer. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, I got the scars to prove that he is a way maker. I've got the scars to prove that he is a burden bearer.
the scars to prove that he is a way out of no way. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he fight your battles? Won't he make your enemies your footstool? Won't he give you joy and sorrow? Won't he give you hope for tomorrow? Won't he dry your tears? Won't he, won't he? Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Hero. Thank you, Mentor. Thank you for everything you've done. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you mean to the body of Christ. Thank you for what you mean to me and my wife. Thank you for who you are to your grandchildren. Thank you for who you are to the Bethel Church. And thank you for helping take full gospel to the next level. Yes! Yeah! Yeah! Ah!
Subscribe to Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube. We post brand new content every week with powerful preaching from ministers and pastors all across the nation that seek to encourage people all over the world through the word of Jesus Christ. You will also find gospel songs and old-time hymns that have inspired generations of Christians. Subscribe today and hit the bell so you never miss new content. YouTube.com/Brother Rollins. Spell it B-R-O-T-H-A Rollins. Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube.